for those of you watching in black and white, this one is in Technicolor.
In a present British music situation, if you look at this album as a pop music product, it's not, if you look at it in a way of sales strategy, it might not, it's not as flashy as you, the music is not directed toward the good, or maybe it's, do you see the...
What? Mine isn't pop product, you know, I would have to disagree there. Without getting too high and mighty about it, but I don't feel my work is pop product. I have to think I write good songs, and I have to think I'm a good singer, and I can play my guitar really well. And that's why people like me, I think.
But in the past, with the Style Council and everything, maybe you didn't market it as a product, but it was thought as product to some people, and it did sell a lot. What do you personally think about that? Or why do you think it did sell?
Well, because they were good songs. If I was concerned about how to sell a record, or what the strategy was, I'd go and work for a record company, you know.
もし売れ行きを気にして、どのような方
向性のものが売れるか売れないか。 Manila Woods was a soldier's tomb, because the witch looked over you. God was there amongst the trees, flowers whisper as the summer breeze. Every night and every day, life touched my soul that way. I remember what it's like to walk amongst butterflies, 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 hey, hey. Butterflies.
What did going into music first mean to you?
Well, sex, drink, drugs, doing your own thing, not being told what to do, you know, not living a conventional lifestyle, not having to get up at certain times of the morning. I mean, all these things turn out to be bullshit a lot of the times, but there's some truth in that, you know, that you do get to direct your own life to a large extent.
Paul and I were always short of money, and we got a job with his dad one summer on an extension he was building. And we were lobbing bricks up to him and carrying cement and whatever, and we were sitting there. At one point, John was on the top of the scaffolding, and I came up the top of some bricks, and he said to me, Paul was fiddling around trying to pick some bricks up down there, and he said, look at that wanker. He said, if he couldn't play a guitar, he said, what fucking oak would there be for him?
Steve Brooks told us you got up one morning and walked the streets of Woking barefoot. Can you tell us what that was about?
Yeah.
What was that about?
I don't know what it was about, you know, we thought we was living some sort of bohemian lifestyle, you know, because we were in a band and we were, you know, hip and all that stuff, you know. This is the kind of glamour I'm talking about. Even at that level, it's still, for us, it's more glamorous than getting up to do your paper round, or, you know, thinking you're going to leave school in 6 weeks' time and join the council, or, you know, work in the garage, which didn't suit me or him.
He was confident of success. That was the thing. Totally confident. Which is really, I mean, it's eerie, in actual fact. For someone that young, too. I read a book recently by Hanif Qureshi called The Buddha of Suburbia. And in it, he says that there's three kinds of people in life. There's those that don't know where they're going and never get there. There's those that don't know where they're going at first but find it later on in life. And there's those that know where they're going from day one. And Paul was one of those.
That's it from Top of the Pops. Good night. We'll see you next week. I'll see you tomorrow morning at 7. And as it's the second time Jam have come straight in at number one, here's a bonus for you. Town Called Mallet.
Best moments of the Jam were definitely things like Top of the Pops, where at the time the producer, Michael Ola, phoned up on a Thursday and said, do you think if the Jam single goes in at number one, because it was double A-side, Town Called Malice and Precious, I said, do you think they'd play both sides? And I went, yeah, yeah. I didn't know this at the time, but like Paul was like on cloud nine as well, because the only time this had ever happened was the Beatles, which was Strawberry Fields Forever and Penny Lane, where they'd had two videos played. Paul was like in his element. You know, he was loving this. You know, this was a proud, proud moment.
Of course people talk about the Jam the same way as people talk about The Who or The Small Faces. You know, they captured a period, full stop.
You know, people forget how big they were. I mean, you know, that they were absolutely, you know, enormous.
I remember getting out the Book of British Hit Singles. Bloody hell, he'd had like 22 hits. Really a successful writer, and that's, you know, what's the most important thing? Songs.
All you got to do is look back through the old NMEs and see who won the polls, who won every poll every year, year after year.
You know, what was it, four records or something straight in at number one? I mean, you know, they were more than just a group.
The group are led by singer and songwriter Paul Weller. At 24, he's become something of a spokesman for the new Beat Generation. He's pronounced on politics, life, and music to fans so enthusiastic to receive his message that they've come from America and Japan to hear him.
Did you want to be Paul Weller?
Oh dear. I suppose really, if I was to be honest, yeah, yes.
What would you advise as a youth spokesman?
I'm not a youth spokesman. You
well,
know.
You know, but...
One of these crummy cliches, well, you know.
No, that is... People do look up to you and listen to what you say, and they listen carefully to your advice. They listen
well,
to you.
You better stop now.
Check these old guys who come down here, look. See these ones here, they must be like professional autograph hunters or something. They always come up, they all side up and go, can we have your autograph, please, Paul? Or Mr. Oh, no, they're very polite, Mr. Weller. And that way, shouldn't we?
Nice well, oh,
mate.
Paul.
How you doing, mate, all right? No, I hope so.
Magic
Buzzard
accident last night.
Can you let the rest of the band in, please?
Yeah. See these windows here, right? Mr. Documentary Maker.
It gets a bit like being in a goldfish bowl, you know, like sort of like the kids out there and now. I can't handle that. And I can't handle sort of hysteria.
Well, there's footage of you at Newcastle Civic Hall.
City Hall.
City Hall. With the fans pressed against the window.
Yeah.
And you're talking about your life in a goldfish bowl. Is that how it felt at the time? Or?
Yeah, I didn't like that at all. That's when it kind of started to sour for me a little bit.
What was it that was souring it for you?
Because you never get any time on your own, and people are hanging on you every word and elevated to this position which you'll never fulfill. No one can fulfill it, you know, and why should you, you know?
But now the Jam have announced they're breaking up. We went to meet Mr. Weller just before he finally unjammed the Jam.
The band is amazingly successful. Why stop now?
Because I feel we've achieved enough, you know. I think we've done all we can do as the three of us. I think it's a good time to finish it. I don't want to drag it on and go on for, like, you know, for the next 20 years doing it and become nothing, mean nothing, end up like all the rest of the groups, you know. I want this to count for something.
What could it count for?
It strikes me that after people get over the age of, like, 25, once they get their house and their wife and their kids, you know, ideals don't mean nothing, you know what I mean?
We wanted to talk to Bruce and Rick in this documentary, but they refused, saying that they didn't want anything to do to promote Paul Weller.
Right.
How does that make you feel?
well,
I don't really expect anything from them, you know. I don't feel they owe me anything, and I don't owe them anything either, you know. So it don't make me feel any particular way, you know. I find it quite... I suppose part of me finds it a little bit sad that they feel that sort of strong about it all, you know. Especially after such a long, long period of time, you know. But I don't know why they feel so hurt, because, you know, we started a band when we were kids, we made it, we had a lot of success. I didn't want to go on, you know, end the story.
Well, I'm determined not to be trapped by, you know, like I said, by the past. And there's some people who will never ever get over the fact that, you know, the Jam aren't together and I'm not writing like I did in the Jam and I'm different from that. But, you know, it's not their life, so I have to ignore all those criticisms.
This song you wrote about bitterness.
Bitterness rising. Well, it's got a line that says, all the past will take you. All the past will take you and keep you from the truth. As bitterness rises from the ashes of your youth.
All the past will take you, keep you from the truth. As bitterness arises from the ashes of your youth. It's just
so you could take it, I guess, as, you know, about England, but for me it's just about myself. It's like a reminder, you know.
Glasgow, the opening show of Paul Weller's debut solo tour.
I don't know what to expect, really. I never know. I always dread the first date because I don't know what to expect at all.
Do you feel nervous?
Yeah. I'm nervous from the time I wake up. It's horrible. It's the thing that ruins touring for me, or playing live, nerves. I guess you need them in some ways because it gives you a kind of edge. It's like, you know, I wake up in a good mood. I wake up in the morning and look out and the sun's shining. Then I remember that I've got to play tonight.
Sanctoni Davi!
I have to be, yeah, if I want to continue playing music for the rest of my life. It's easy to be sort of, to be dedicated when you're successful. If you're selling lots of records or playing big gigs, it's a lot easier in a way, you know. And I think the real test is when, you know, you don't sell so many records or you don't play such big places. It's the real kind of showdown in that.
Ohio.
Congratulations to your album.
Oh, thank you.
It's just fantastic.
Oh, great.
How come?
How come?
There's this change from Jam, like post-punk and pre-wave and late mod.
You've lost me.
No, it's really, it's kind of broody. Especially the second part of the album. The first side is a bit different, it's more like bar music, but the second...
Bar music.
In this album, you strive to make like the English R&B sound, and is this like a type of music that you like to continue, or is it...
Yeah, I think I like to develop that, yeah. Mm-hmm. And it mainly comes from the sort of groups that I was influenced by, mm-hmm. and still am influenced by. John and Paul both, you know, probably equally. Probably Lennon more so.
Why Lennon?
Well, I mean, apart from the obvious thing, they were great songwriters and he was a great singer. But I liked his character as well, that he just did what he believed in and fucked off anyone who didn't, stood in his way, you know. Get up, Laura!
Can you tell us about the night you went to see the Sex Pistols?
It was, whenever it was, in the summer of 76. And I'd read a review in the NME, and, you know, it just sounded what I was looking for, really, in a way. You know, they were kind of, the fact they were a young band and had attitudes. And so we decided to go and see them next time they played. And we set this all-nighter at the Lyceum. And they were the last band on, and I guess they'd come out at 6 in the morning or something like that, I don't know. And we were all speeding out of our heads, which was brilliant. And just the whole experience, you know. And that kind of swung it for me. It was like, well, there is a scene going here. And, you know, I wanted to be part of it.
This song's for Fat Councillors. A song called Bricks and Mortar.
Now, lots of people have written about you as being kind of style obsessed. Out of all the, especially when the punk movement was on, if it was a movement, people it was deemed to be anti-fashion, and then you were there, and you were kind of the opposite: sharp suits and the shoes. I mean, are you obsessed with style? Is that such a big thing in your life?
I don't know if I'm obsessed with style. I mean, I'm just into what I'm into. I don't really make a big deal of it. I don't think. I don't feel I do anyway. And to me, it's like a religion. You know, it's like being a Catholic or whatever.
In what way is it like being a Catholic then, Bob?
I don't know, that's why it's sounding good. No, I don't know, well, it's just, you know, I'm into that, that's like, it's like my code in a way. Yeah. It gives something to my life.
It's very
but
much...
it's not a big deal at the same time, you know, there are higher things to think about, but I like clothes, so
it,
what?
It was the sort of mod thing, wasn't it? Is that what it's come out
yeah,
of? Still?
Yeah, I'm still a mod, I'll always be a mod. You can bury me a mod.
Well, that, you know, it's an arrogant thing to say, but if I had to sum up mods or modernism, I would say it's about good taste, you know, which sets me up as saying I've got good taste, you know. Mm. But there we go, I've just set myself up there.
Mother did the Small Faces fan club in the 60s, which is probably why I became a mod in the first place.
The little tin soldier that wants to jump into your fire.
My mother, in fact, commented upon the fact that Steve Marriott was on telly, come and have a look, and in fact it was Paul Weller, but he was wearing exactly the same outfit as Steve Marriott in some of the photos that we had at home.
What about Weller? Did you like him?
Look, I'll be honest with you, I've only seen the Jam once on a video.
Yeah.
And I thought it reminded me of me in the old days. So for me to say that, is he sure I like me? So it's not as if I can really judge them, I just saw them and they looked exactly like we did and they played very similarly.
Yeah.
At the same time, I admire their taste.
But, I mean, I was always out to emulate all my heroes, you know.
When you say emulate, what do you mean?
You know, copy their clothes, sound, stage movements, all those things, you know. Lennon, Marriott, Townsend, obviously.
How do you answer people who say that your music is plagiaristic?
Well, I suppose they're right, up to a point, you know. Half of it is, and half of it's original, so, you know. How do you answer that?
I don't know whether he owns up to it or not, but whenever we used to sort of sit there and be stuck for inspiration, we'd drag the Beatles complete out and say, well, there's a chord sequence, let's have a go with that and change it round a bit. Yeah, we'll make a song out of that, call it something else.
But, you know, there's some influences in my music which that will never be taken out, you know. The 60s stuff that I grew up on, you know, R&B stuff. I can't separate those things, you know. I can't take them out of my music, and I don't wish to either.
You know, we'd get together at a weekend if we hadn't seen one another a week. He'd say, I've got a new song, and he'd play it, and I'd be really knocked out by it. And then, sort of, a couple of months later, I'd hear a very similar thing, you know, from an old Beatles album or something like that, you know, so...
We all started somewhere, and we all wanted to be someone else when we started out, you know. The Beatles wanted to be Little Richard, or the Shirelles, or the Stones wanted to be Howlin' Wolf, or Jimmy Reed, or, you know. I'm sure Stevie Wonder wanted to be Sly Stone in the late 60s, you know. So we've all been there. It all depends what you do with those influences, and, you know.
I mean, I'm not saying he's a plagiarist, because it's, again, you know, what is plagiarism, you know, what is influence? And so many people have done it subconsciously. I think that's where it gets unfair.
What do you think the qualities are within your music that sets it apart, that makes it your own?
I mean it.
Something like Star was such a blatant, sort of obvious rip-off of Taxman that I'm surprised they got away with it.
And some of my stuff in the past has been out-and-out copies, you know. A Town Called Malice with the kind of Motown, you know, Martha Reeves beat, or Star with the Taxman backing, you know. But I don't think I was expecting anyone not to notice that. I mean, I thought they were kind of vehicles. It was like, I've got an idea, quick, get a structure together, bang, you know. We just done those tracks on the spot in the studio, you know. We were listening to Revolver 5 minutes beforehand, so, you know, we're jamming on Taxman. They were as simple as that, you know. If I sat down with an acoustic guitar and played Malice on it, it wouldn't sound anything like Motown.
You better stop dreaming of the quiet life, cos it's the one you'll never know. And keep running for the runaway bus, cause those rosy days are few. And stop apologizing for the things you never done. It's like this show, time is cold. It's up to us to change this time called Malice. Rows and rows of disused hippos and dying in the dairy yard. And 100 lonely housewives clutch empty milk bottles to their hearts. Oh, hanging out their roll of letters on the line to dry. It's enough to make you stop believing. The tears come fast and furious in a town called Malice. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Come on. Struggle year after year. The atmosphere's the fine blend of mice. I'm almost stone cold there in a town called Malice. The ghost of a steam train echoes down my track. It's at the moment bound for nowhere, just going round and round. Playground kids and creaking swings, just laughter in the breeze. I'm the gone for hours and I probably will, but I'm soon supposed to come back in this time of Malice. Hey, hey, hey. This time of Malice. Oh, oh, yeah.
rows and rows of disused milk floats staying dying in the dairy yard.
There's a dairy yard in Woking?
Down Goldsworth Road, yeah. And it's funny how those images stay with you, you know. You can draw on those images still.
Do you write those lyrics?
Yeah, I think I really like Tackle Manish, yeah. There's maybe two lines in the whole song I don't really like. But whole street's belief in Sunday's roast beef, you know, I think they're great lines. They're great suburban lines, you know.
If you want to write a song that means a lot to a lot of people, you need to touch their experience pretty deep. You don't do it by being a lowest common denominator. You do it by going as deep as you can in your own experience, because you know inside we've all of us experienced similar sort of things, even if it's only we all know the names of the characters on the Magic Roundabout.
So is that Willard's strength?
That's what Willard does. I think he's aware of that, and he goes in with and uses an imagery that's deep in the English psyche.
Girls, they dig in. Saturdays girls work in Tesco's and Woolworths, wear cheap perfume cause it's all they can afford. Go to discos, they do baby sham, talk to Jan in bingo accents.
Saturday's kids live in council houses, wear V-neck shirts and baggy trousers, drive Cortinas with fur-rimmed dashboards, stains on the seats in the back, of course. But I mean, this is, you know, it's the same sort of Saturday's Kids is, when you read it like this, is similar to That's Entertainment. He's painting a picture of the you know, of urban life and the dead end sort of attitude, you know, in the same way that Ray Davies was.
Do you like being English?
It's hard to say really, because I've never been German or Hungarian, you know.
I see a world which I'm very familiar with, which I've walked through. I never did work in Tesco's and Woolworths, and I don't smoke caps in full strength, and I haven't got a Cortina, but I know a man who does.
I'm quite a fan of Paul's love songs, I mean, as well as like political songs or whatever you want to call them. It's a bit crass to sort of carve it into two like that, but he's quite good on a kind of romantic poet level, you know.
Star Council a better group than the Jam?
They were a different group.
The Style Council present our favourite shop. 14 classic tracks, including the hit single Walls Come Tumbling Down, available on record, cassette and compact disc. In your favourite shop now.
Well, Style Council for me was going to be a vehicle where I could have someone to work with, someone to bounce off, but to try and keep the lineup changing and the music changing and not get stuck in a sound. You're the best thing I ever had.
Style Council didn't come vaguely close to the emotions captured by the Jam. Musically, I'm sure they were, you know, far superior. But that's no substitute for raw, gutsy passion.
When is a pop group not a pop group, you know? When it's the Style Council, that was our thing.
Yeah, all right, Paul.
I mean, we're only a pop group.
I mean, I suppose one of the greatest things for me is that when I look at the future now, I just think there's so many things, so many more things we can do. It's just, you know, I just think it's endless possibilities.
Do you know what sort of possibilities? Do you have any distinct idea? Or do you take it as it comes?
No, it's, it's a bit like a musical Kama Sutra, you know?
I like that, don't you? I'm glad you stated your position.
Sometimes people got bored with it, some people found the kind of humour a bit clicky and this, that and the other. And some people just seem to think someone like Paul Weller shouldn't be trying to be funny. And maybe they were right, it depends on the jokes.
The Multicolour Swap Shop, I said to Paul, listen, you know, they've had you on for like years and years and years, but you've never actually appeared live on a programme. And he was, at the Style Council, it was like, you know, the relief valve, the steam valve had been let off. There was wasn't this pressure on him. And he got on, and I think it was Mike Read at the time said, you know, so, you know, he was on with about three other people, and Mike Read said, okay, Paul, you know, what do you think of this video?
I don't like him at all.
There isn't a song there, as Richard rightly pointed out, so I won't give any mark to that one.
I went, oh, no.
No marks at all, the first of the morning there.
So anyway, the next one came round, and it came round to his turn, and he gave it zero again, and I just was dying at this point. You know, I just thought this was a little unfair on any artist, because surely he must respect that any artist is trying.
I read you this NME review.
Please do.
Which is, they have two people reviewing your single. One is the journalist, Gina Morris.
Oh, yeah.
And the second is a guy called Fret Anderson of Suede. You familiar with Suede?
I've heard of them, yeah.
Have you heard their music?
No.
Right. Okay, this is what the journalist says. If you don't refill the kettle, you don't get any steam. And Weller's creative taps appear to have run dry. Nevertheless, Aha is possibly the best thing he's done in a long time. The bass line is callously robbed from Gary Newman's Cars, and the B-sides are saturated in tediously pompous jazz. I still believe he should sod off and let us cherish our Jam records in peace, but he won't. Only good if you've never heard That's Entertainment. The second one is old Brett from Suede.
Right.
All I can say is, how the mighty have fallen, eh? I mean, what is that? It's not even a Style Council B-side. He's lost his edge. Is that what happens to you when you get your flat in Kensington and you make records to pay for your new swimming pool? He doesn't need to make records anymore. He's obviously lost his passion for music, or he wouldn't make such an in-between record. If you're going to make a commercial record, you make a huge fucking pop song. You don't fall halfway between that and some freeform jazz.
Well, both wankers completely. I don't know. I couldn't, you know, begin to sort of. There's just, you know, I don't know what are the, where are they at? Do you know what I mean? How do they see it all? I don't know. I haven't got much to say about it really.
Right.
Just, you know, can't be fucked with them all. They don't know enough about music and enough about me to sort of. But I don't know. You know, they don't like it. It's fair enough. I suppose. I don't know. But they went to me. They went because I don't give a fuck about them.
I think the interesting thing is how personal they get.
Yeah. Well, it's like a personal, I don't think.
No, I think. Get that worked up about it.
I've said worse things about people.
Oh,
First rays of summer sun coming down and shining. And if I open my head, remember all that we said. Hey, baby, what will you find coming down to meet you? Something real is what I'm seeking. What they'll fight some over this.
Constantly have to prove yourself.
What's that like?
I think it's tiring.
Wee!
Tell you what, Paul. It's really coming on, isn't it? It's getting there.
Right. You know, I'm a very moody person and people get pissed off with that around me. They get fed up with me being moody and my moods change erratically and stuff like that. But, you know, that's part of it. You know, my thing is always, can't you see that's part of it, you know? I can't be this good sometimes, you know? I just blow my own trumpet, but I can be really good at times, you know? But you don't get it for nothing, I don't think. There's always going to be a downside to it, you know.
Can't you see, can't you see? Everything has a price to pay.
Sounds better on guitar, though.
Can everybody hurry up and get ready then? Let's go. We've got a long drive.
Moody? What, Paul Weller? Never. He's about the most moodiest person I've ever met in my life.
Yeah, well, I'm the sort of person, I don't like to be boxed in, you know. I don't like people feeling they can sum me up in a couple of nifty phrases or sentences, you know.
I'm going to read out some words and you tell me if you think Paul fits them.
Mm-hmm.
Happy?
Yeah.
Dour?
No, not really.
Dour?
Yeah.
Serious?
Generous?
Yeah.
Selfish?
Yeah.
Spoilt little brat?
Yep.
No fun?
Puritan.
Wimpish?
No.
Macho?
Yeah. So Sorry, babe.
Wouldn't you rather have been the bass player in Status Quo? 20 years of success and none of the grief?
No, I don't really know. My ego or my ambition or whatever is too big for that. I want something more from life. I always wanted more, you know. But you see, also, the way this whole interview and the questions are geared, it makes me sort of sound like it's all pain and misery and suffering, I feel. Which it isn't. Most of it's fun. I can't think of a better job to have than this, you know. It's all that stuff as well. But as soon as you've decided on a solemn interview, I'm giving solemn answers.
Please drink and sing. Let's have a party and to kanpai shou ka? Kanpai!
With us, don't worry, Paul. Whilst enjoying considerable chart success, no one could actually accuse you of sort of being a purveyor of pop pap. Do you see music really primarily as a propaganda machine for all the issues that you feel strongly about?
It's partly that, yeah, but I mean, it's also a vehicle to put across my ideas. Whether that comes across as propaganda is, you know, it's not for me to decide, really.
Once he led The Jam through their series of hit singles, now he plays more sophisticated and often political styles with The Style Council. Hush now, Jam. He has packed the Albert Hall, but also given benefits for CND or the miners.
You know, I've got a chance to say something through my work, which goes out to a lot of people, not only in this country, but all over the world. There's a little bit there. So, you know, I mean, I've got a good opportunity to actually express my feelings. And that's what I do. I mean, it's like I've said in the past, if I was an author, I wouldn't get questioned so much about is this the right thing to do, you know, should politics be in music? It's only because I'm working within pop music that people question it and say, well, pop music is supposed to be about frivolity and the joys of life.
Tell us about the Red Wedge.
Well, it's a collective of different musicians and different artists who are of the left, shall we say, not necessarily for the Labour Party, but certainly not opposed to it either.
Because you've got to keep a kind of media profile, it kind of dragged musicians in a bit too deep. I felt that some of them press conferences, people were being really put on the spot. I mean, really, I guess you set yourself up for it.
I get the feeling that you're very patriotic.
I used to be. I'm not so much anymore. Not after the Falklands, all right.
What? Well, can you explain that? I mean, life to you in Thatcher's Britain.
For liberty there is a cost. It's broken skulls and leather cosh. From the boys in uniform. Now you know whose side they're on. With backing. With blessing from earthly gods, not ever a stone's throw away from it all.
The sky was lit up as petrol bombs lobbed from the flats landed among the police. In the words of one senior officer, it wasn't England, it was madness.
I've got negative feelings on a lot of it. I thought it was good to try at the time. I thought, you know, whatever misgivings I had about being involved with the Labour Party or becoming that kind of partisan anyway were kind of overshadowed by the fact that, you know, we should try and get people motivated and, you know, get younger people out thinking about politics and maybe change the way things were going in the country. naive or not.
I mean, I've been followed into toilets and called a communist by mobs of furrowed-browed youngsters who've told us that we used to like you before you were turned communist.
Like today, like those interviews are saying, well, you know, there is no politics in music, but I've never written like that anyway, you know. If I feel like it, the songs come out that way, that's the way it is, do you know what I mean? It's always been like that.
Can you put a smile back on all these different faces of all these people from just different places? And if you can't succeed, what then will you achieve with a different tune to play? You've been saving for a rainy day. Scar that song, the years been wasted, the tears spent off the past, just filling spaces, just love forever gone, but it's too small a part, hide behind your wall and start to get to the very heart. Oh, and if you won't shoot the moon, make sure that you know why, be careful, fly too soon, better let someone else try. I'm a weaver of your dreams, I get rid of the boogeyman. Get a smash to show your mind up and get you into another flame. I'm a weaver of your dreams, I move prayer to the rocket man. Get a break the spell your mind up and get you started with another plan.
Well, the Jam were very kind of confrontational. And your character is quite confrontational as well.
Yeah.
But when you go to the Style Council, that's kind of gets buried.
Well, I disagree, because I think the Style Council were just as, if not more, confrontational, you know.
I mean, we had a big hit with Solid, what was it called? Walls Come Tumbling Down. That was the first hit he had around Europe, really, apart from he had Long Hot Summer, didn't he? That was a hit like in France and a couple of other places. Walls Come Tumbling Down did well everywhere. And then things looked like they were going like this, and then they just, that orange album, I sort of seem to remember it, you know, so like an albatross.
Is that the one that was packaged in a pink?
Orange cover.
Right. Now, that wasn't the Polydor's fault. It was their fault, in one sense. And I'm saying this, and Paul was saying, but in one respect, he had an orange thing, right, which he said, well, that'll be good enough, you know. And the Cost of Loving on it, or the Style Council on it, you might as well put it upside down backwards, because you wouldn't know what it said anyway.
We didn't think it was a good idea having an orange sleeve, you know. Great, it was a good idea for the Beatles in 1967, but, you know, they were somewhat bigger.
And the packaging was crap, and the presentation was crap. They should, not crap, yeah, crap.
I felt there was many things wrong with that record, but rather than confront, I didn't confront. Now, I wish I had, actually.
Did you say that to Paul at the time? Did you say that?
Yeah, I did, yeah. I said, I don't know how much of the presentation. Mm. I don't know. It was in.
Yeah, that's it.
And I don't think the record company did, but they should have stuck to their guns.
I remember doing an interview with somebody, like a, you know, business interview thing, after I left Polly, and I was saying, what was your biggest regret? Well, I didn't actually confront Paul Weller and John Weller about that record, because it was the beginning of, you know, a slide in his career. A lot of pop artists, musicians, like to make films. I wish they didn't.
The view in front of me was one that eased my heart. For sitting in his throne in front of the troubled sea, Paul Welly was busy commanding the waves that would so ravage his body.
Go back, for my parts do freeze. Thus I say, go back.
I mean, I remember, like, seeing that and sort of like, you know, what's that all about, you know? I mean, it was very out there, really.
Now, boys and girls, tell me, how did you form?
Yeah, two middle-class guys, Bob with life, Bob with grammar school, want to rock out a little, you know. I phone him, and he says, and there we are.
It's their magical mystery tour, their tragical history tour, I suppose, in retrospect.
That's another story.
And the whole thing became too in for a lot of people. That the whole kind of like outlook of the band became very sort of inward, like the humour was like very insular, and I think a lot of the fans just basically didn't really understand it, which, you know, is sort of fair enough. Maybe that was like the sort of beginning of the time when the band just kind of sort of fell apart.
Were you trying to wind up your original Jam audience?
I think maybe I was trying to sort of see how far I could go with it and see how far I could take it, you know. But at the same time, I still think, you know, I could reel off a whole list of, I thought, what I think are great songs that we, you know, did with the Style Council.
Keep on diving till I reach the end, dredging up the past to drive me round the bends. What is it in me that I can't forget? I keep finding so much that I now regret. Would no one to go down into the depths, turning things over, but I bet I left. Dredging up the past that is gone for good, trying to polish up what is rotting wood.
I think the first two Style Council albums were the biggest two, and the next one had not done as well. And after that, we really tried to get Paul to address that problem. And it's not an unusual problem in an artist's career to have peaks and troughs in success and creative juices flowing and so on.
Tell me about David Mumms. Because you ran into a lot of trouble with him.
No, this is where you're going to get a lot of trouble. You're going to cut this lot out, right? Because I ain't going to talk about him.
Was it a very frictional relationship with the Wellers?
I'm a fairly direct person who speaks his mind, so we did have some disagreements, but they were healthy disagreements. In other words, we didn't fall out over it particularly. Although Paul was reluctant to talk to me much direct. But at the end, it got a little more difficult.
Well, can you tell us about the end? They went in to make an album which you wouldn't release.
Yeah, they made an album and I didn't think it was good enough. I think it would have prolonged the agony if it had been released at that time. And I think one of the jobs of a record company is to stand your ground with an artist and say, you know, this is not going to do what you want it to do.
And I feel that we kind of become victims of our own kind of our own wind-ups, you know. I think if we'd have steered clear of all that stuff and cut down on press and not done so much stuff, and basically me kept me trapped shut most of the time, you know, and just got on with the music, it'd have been a different outlook altogether.
You were dropped by Polydor and you disappeared from the public eye for a long time. What happened?
Yeah, a lot of things kind of happened at the same time, you know. I had a child, I got married. Well, the other way around, you know. And I became 30. I had no record deal, no band, no publishing deal, so it was, you know, it was a clean board, he could start again, you know, but I couldn't see it that way at the time.
The only thing that worried me was that he was worried. He was kind of worried, and he could see himself trying, or it looked to me they was kind of trying to get back into it and couldn't.
I lost the plot on it all, you know. I didn't write that, you know, I wasn't writing anymore. And even the stuff I was writing didn't really excite me or fire me up in any way. I didn't feel I was doing anything new, I was just covering the same old ground, you know.
Over all the years, I've always gone for periods of time when I haven't been out to write. And I get panicky for, like, you know, it might last 6 months, it might last, you know, however long. But it would always return. But it didn't return for a long, long time.
He wasn't doing anything creative, he was getting to a stage where he was really getting on my nerves, and I was really wishing he would just, like, get back in the studio.
My biggest fear would be not to be able to write ever. Because it's my outlet, you know, it's how I really, really express myself. And when I can really pull all my ideas together and really articulate them and put them into a song, it's the best feeling for me, you know.
What was the first song you wrote that gave you back your confidence?
Probably Into Tomorrow.
Yeah. Into the mists of time and space, where we have no say over day and place. Oh yeah. Don't get embarrassed if it happens a lot. You don't know how you started or when you're gonna stop. Oh yeah. And if at times it seems insane, all the tears and searching, turning all your joy to pain, in pursuit of learning, my dream and hide away, can I escape the suffering? And won't you will have no effect as we head into tomorrow.
Well, you've been offered deals on this album, which so far you seem to have resisted or turned down, or why is that?
Well, because I think they're selling me short, you know. And I feel what I've got is worth a whole lot more than that.
Was the response that you got, was the interest you got as much as it...
No, it was awful.
Was it?
Yeah, it was awful. I mean, let's be fair, because it was bloody awful. I mean, you thought I was talking about Tommy Tucker or something, or somebody you'd never know, or Sophie Tucker, and she's dead. You know what I mean?
Would you see this album sink rather than accept a deal which was under what you think you're worth?
Yeah, at times I feel I would do that. But then, you know, I'm very kind of headstrong on some things, and some of the things... Well, I'll go and burn the master tapes if they're still offering me, or I'll go and throw them away. But, you know, that's bullshit.
I was playing records to some young guy. I'm not against youth, good luck to youth, right? But some guy who don't know shit from clay, right? As far as I'm concerned. And I don't know much about other people's music, agreed. And I wasn't asking him about other people's music, I was asking about my son's music, Paul Weller, who should be pretty well known by all the media and everybody within the business. They all knew him, and they would listen, and you'd have some young guy going, well, you know, and it was a load of rubbish. And then, you know, I'd take, give me that tape back, and I used to piss off and leave him out there.
We're not asking for, like, millions and millions anyway. You know, we're just asking for a decent deal. And some of the monies that they're offering, you know, I'd expect they'd offer to a new band or something, you know. So, you know, I don't like people taking the piss.
Do you think it was Paul's reputation? I mean, Paul's got
possibly. That's what we spoke about, me and Paul. I said, maybe.
You get these people in business saying, yeah, he's an awkward bastard, or he's really hard to work with. Well, they always say that about people who just want to do what they want to do their own thing, you know. And just because you want to stick out for something, it makes you awkward, or, you know. Well, to me, it makes people strong, you know. I like people like that.
High tide, mid-afternoon, people fly by, and the traffic's boom. No way. Where you're blowing, getting to where you should be going. Don't let them get you down, making you feel guilty about
of the good things you deserve now.
TV lot one.
They want
so they
want
to talk
too much. Do the interview.
Right. Half hour interview.
They want half hour to do the interview in, and then they want to film one number, and they're going to take the mix from that number off of the BBC.
Why don't they film two numbers and just start chatting them for 10 minutes?
How long do you need?
15.
Yeah, depends on if you talk slow or fast. Just kidding.
Well, okay. The artist Play the Game was called Playing the Game within the music business. Do you feel that you are at the moment?
Playing the game? Mm. I don't think I've ever played the game. I don't think I've ever copped out. I don't think I ever will do.
What does playing the game mean to you?
Playing the game, I suppose, you know, going along with what the company wants to do, going along with what your audience wants to do, what the business wants you to do, you know. That's playing the game.
Would you say you have mellowed at all, or...?
Yeah, up to a point, yeah. Thank God, yeah.
Why would you be dedicated and
older? Well, I wouldn't like to be running around at 34 still pretending to be a teenager, you know. I think it'd be quite depressing, really.
Do you think that it could be a fun thing to do, to play the game then?
And what?
And take off.
And what after that, you know? What would you do after that? You know, if I played the game in the, if we talk about the same terms, those things only last for a period of time. It all depends what you're out to do, you know. If you're out just to make the bucks, then yeah, you know, but it'll only last for a period of time, you know. What I set out to do is something with a lot more longevity than that.
Do you think when, like, you were younger that you know, like, say 10, 15 years ago, that you thought you had more of the answers and that people should know, or...?
Yeah, I'm sure it was like that, yeah. That's just a symptom of being young, you know. Sometimes you're right, but, you know, things change in life.
You know, I'm 35, you know. I'm here to play music, I'm not to, you know... I've got attitude and I've got ideas and philosophies about this and that, but so what, you know? At the end of the day, I should just get on and do what I do best. That's what I feel I've learned over the years, you know?
In your song, Shadows of the Sun, which seems quite a reflective thing, and you talk about wanting it all while you're still young and you can see what you have done. What do you see when you look back?
Someone who's been able to fulfill a dream, you know, in life, which is pretty unique, I think. All those kind of crazy notions I had when I was a kid about being in a band, let alone making a record, you know, let alone making it, and people, you know, a lot of people liking what I do. You know, it all happened, you know.
Once upon a time, I might have told you, but I know if it sees that play. Thank you.
your copyright.
It strikes me that after people get over the age of like 25, once they get their house and their wife and their kids, you know, ideals don't mean nothing, you know what I mean?
Bye-bye.